I came to Jesus, sick of sin. He did not fail me then. He made me new without within, and did not fail me then. I came to him the second time for cleansing from the inbred sin. He satisfied my longing then. He will not fail me now. He stilled the storms and calmed my fears, forgave my sins and dried my tears. He is the same years. He will not fail me now. When Satan tried to draw me back, Christ did not fail me then, but kept me on the upward track. And did not fail me then. When Satan tried his worst to do, my Lord was by my side, I knew. He answered prayer and took me through. He not fail me now. He stilled the storms and calmed my fears, forgave my sins and dried my tears. He is the same through endless years. Fail me now. When in affliction, grief, and pain, he did not fail me then. When no one cared, I came to him, he did not fail. Trusted him for keeping grace, to walk the path his hand did trace, and said while looking on his face, he will not fail me now. When Abraham obeyed the Lord, he did not fail him then. And others faced their fire and sword, he did not fail them then. Lean hard on him, O tested soul, on him your cares and burdens roll. Our God still lives and has control. He will not fail.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Edith's granddaughter, Andrea, and I'm going to read a poem. It's entitled, I'm Tired. God saw you were getting tired and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, come to me. With tearful eyes, we watched you and saw you pass away. Although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. Our golden heart stopped beating, hard-working hands at rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best.
Thank you. shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
His sister is received for Christian burial. With faith in Jesus Christ, receive the body of our sister Edith Adele for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember for you this day our sister Edith Adele. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and love as our companion on this earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before through Jesus Christ, O Lord.
Your Excellency, the Most Honorable Dame Sandra Mason, President of Barbados, Priest in Charge, Reverend Guy, relative friends and well-wishers. During my many years as an educational administrator, I was invited to address various audiences at different institutions, including those attending graduations and funeral services. Some presented no major challenges, while others presented a bit of anxiety and trepidation. However, none of those experiences can compare with the sense of loss and inner turmoil which overcame us ever since our mother died. The reason for this strange and different feeling that lingers is the fact that my dear mother is the subject of my eulogy. On behalf of the Mason, Butcher, and other families, I wish at the very outset to extend to you profound appreciation and gratitude for your presence at this ceremony. A very special welcome, of course, is extended to the President, Dame Sandra. Your regular presence at functions like these indicate that you haven't forgotten your roots and that you're a real Mason. The support of all of you is necessary, for it helps to soothe the aching hearts of those of us who are struck by the relatively sudden loss of the matriarch of our family. Special thanks to those who visited the homestead and those who posted very complimentary and uplifting tributes on social media following her death. A very special welcome is also extended to the relatives and friends who came in from overseas. According to her birth certificate, Edith Adele Butcher, and she would call herself sometimes Mason Butcher, was born to Theodora and Thomas Maloney Mason on January 14, 1925. However, she was always adamant that the certificate was incorrect, since her mother always told her that January 12th was indeed the correct date. She died at 3:30 p.m. on September 20th, 2023, at age 98, roughly 15 months before her 100th birthday. Madam President, we were hoping for a visit from you on that occasion, but that was not to be. She died as she lived, peacefully and quietly. It must be noted that longevity is a major characteristic of the Mason clan. Her mother died in 1985 at age 101. Her five sisters, Lillian, Irene, Vadna, Miriam, and Louise, along with one brother, Joseph, all lived past 90 years. Three of her brothers, Arthur, Ulrich, and Robert, narrowly missed that high pinnacle. But the other one, the last one, Alfred, he died at a relatively young age following an industrial accident. Her death, therefore, has brought to an end a highly significant chapter in the Mason's history book. Gone is the sole remainder of those unsung heroes, those nation builders, who sowed the seed from which the Mason's pride had sprung. They came from very humble beginnings, but still achieved very much. In 1949, she married Calvin Vernon Butcher, a very skillful sugar factory engineer. I recall as boys visiting throughout this factory regularly to see him operate the hoist. He assisted in the home with the financial and other requirements and was a disciplinarian. We had to be perfectly quiet in the house when the BBC News was coming through. He died in 1985 at age 64. That union produced seven children. Two of them, the last two, Elliot and Maureen, died in infancy, while five of us survive and are here today. I refer to Sheila, Rosling, Berkeley, David, and myself. She nurtured us with tender, loving care and modeled a very high standard of moral, ethical, and social behavior for us to emulate. She was a virtuous woman. She taught us to be mannerly and respectful with her. In all the years we were under her care, I have never seen or heard her engage in any unseemly or disrespectful behavior with anyone, neighbor or stranger. She was always gentle, pleasant, and endearing. Her grandchildren, starting with Sharon, were also the beneficiaries of her warmth, kindness, and protection. Their arrival in her clan brought her real joy and happiness. She visited them in England and the United States of America and spent many days babysitting those, especially Terrence, who were based in Barbados. On many occasions, they sought permission to sleep over at her home because they loved her and wanted to be with her. Her mother was multi-talented and used her tremendous skills and knowledge to good effect. As a young adult, she joined the Eastern Melody Choir, which was virtually a choir comprising mainly Masons and friends. She and her late sister Louise team up to be one of the best alto combinations in the service of sound movement. The choir was directed by her brother, Joseph, and was well known countrywide. She was also well known for her needlework skills. She worked very closely with her sister Vadna, or Aunt Glenn as we call her, who was famous for the high quality of bridal wear she produced. Her mother also made her daughter's dresses and manufactured pants and shirts for her sons. It is my firm belief that those two could have been a successful, formidable team in the business world if they were privileged to have the necessary financial and other resources. Another source of income came as she was occasionally invited by her two sisters, Irene and Lillian, to assist with socials held at Tickets Plantation House, where they were employed. But above all, her main source of income was fish vending. I can picture her now with a heavy tray of fish on her head with a little cloth pad in between, making her way to Church Village, St. Philip, and beyond. She and other relatives like Stella Mason, Louise Mason, and Ruby Wiltshire would often make the entire journey by foot in order not to miss potential customers and also to avoid the ridicule of some intolerant bus commuters. We often shared her frustration when she related stories of people who credited their fish during the week but could not be found on Sunday mornings when it was time to pay, as they would say, pick up the money. They believe in trust, but don't pay. Edith Adele was a very devout Christian. She prayed fervently and read her Bible daily for edification, education, and inspiration. She worshiped at this church for many years, but later transferred to the Bible Missionary Church, located in her beloved fishing village, Bayfield. She was a major pillar in that religious group, along with other stalwarts like Ruby Wiltshire, Lestrade Maloney, Houston Innes, and her adopted son, who you heard singing earlier, the Reverend Carlos Mason. She very ably led the praise and worship sessions of the various services, melodiously rendered some of her favorite songs to the congregation, visited the sick and shut-ins, particularly on Sunday afternoons, and was a very prominent member of open-air meetings, sponsored by her church, led by foreign missionaries in those early years, and later by Sister Ernestine Knight. For many years, she served as Sunday school superintendent and organized many functions for children of the area, particularly at Easter and Christmas. She was well loved by the children, who respected her for the excellent work she did with them. Today, many of them still hail her for the positive impact she has made on their lives. When one seriously examines and analyzes her entire life, one cannot but realize that her philosophy of life embodied faith, hope, and love. These were quite obvious in her character. Like the Bible, she interpreted faith as the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. To her, faith gave substance to the things she hoped for. She regularly expressed the hope of seeing her Heavenly Father someday. She would often remind us that if we wanted to see her again after her death, we would have to repent and serve God. I'm still working on that. Her love for her family and people generally was always quite clear. Her faith and hope were again clearly manifested when she accepted the advice of the late priest of this church and St. Mark's, Reverend William Braffitt, and sent her first child and daughter, Sheila, to secondary school. Sheila's outstanding success motivated the rest of us to want to learn. Her mother struggled to pay school fees for the first three of her children at private school. The last two of us, David and I, attended Princess Margaret Secondary School, where there were no fees. If there were fees, they would not have gone to school. Her faith, hope, and love led her to explore other income-earning activities. She then turned her attention to smocking, the cultivation of a large kitchen garden, rearing animals, and particularly sheep and pigs for sale, while still continuing her fish vending routine. You could well imagine the great sense of feeling of arrival and the jubilation in our household when our first sister, our oldest sister, Sheila, started to teach at Bailey's Primary. Imagine how well that did it helps. Then Roslyn migrated to England to pursue nursing. Then Bertie started to teach at Holy Trinity. Then I started to teach at St. Mark's, my alma mater. And then David joined the Harrison Shipping Line, traveling all over the world while earning more money than any of his siblings. The sum total of the monthly contributions of each of us to our mother's coffers exceeded the salaries of many civil servants of the day. We tried to get her to stop work, but she would stop. She was particularly proud that each of her children started to work at age 18. Her abiding faith in her God, her hope for better days to come, and her deep and unconditional love for her children could not be more evident. She understood the value of education and its role in upward social and economic mobility, and always made sure that we were positioned to benefit from it. Although she did not attend secondary school, she benefited from a very sound primary school education at St. Mark's Girls. Her reading, writing, and computational skills were of a high standard. She was also very observant and would relate some hilarious stories, some involving her head teacher, Miss Kane. Further evidence of her intellect was her ability to play Wari, an African game which she very frequently played with her favorite grandson, Terence. He spent several hours on a daily basis attending to her needs, thus minimizing the possibility of loneliness, boredom, and despair. She looked forward to his frequent visits when they would spend many hours of quality time together. He deserved a high level of praise for that caring attitude. Similarly, his mother, Sheila, a retired British trained nurse, provided invaluable service to her mother's welfare. Equally important is the contribution of David, who was always resident in the homestead and did much to ensure that she was safe and comfortable. Those of us based abroad made regular contact online. We visited home occasionally and assisted in our limited way to her well-being. Special mention must be made of Laurel Pinder, Gail Fingal, Del Maynard, and Ruthin Clark for their love and care demonstrated over the years. Also worth of mention are Dr. Azim Adam and Dr. Jamal Bartlett, who paid home visits and administered much needed medical care, along with Mr. Michael Smith, pharmacist of Bayview Hospital, who facilitated the acquisition of the necessary medication. Her mother was always so very gracious in her expression of thanks to all who in any way assisted her. She has always taught us that in everything we should give thanks. She lived by that rule. She instilled in us that spirit of humility and humanity and peace. Even in her declining years, we continued to be fascinated by her wit and charm. She would regularly and correctly name all the books of the Bible, recite the names of her siblings and her children in order of birth, recite her favorite psalm, Psalm 23, and sing many inspirational songs and hymns. She was a very strong believer who prayed fervently and sang with passion and sincerity. Her tongue is now silent, but I am persuaded that we will still hear her beautiful voice and her customary words of praise and thanksgiving ringing continually in our ears. We love her and will forever be grateful to God for giving to us such a loving, caring, and wonderful mother. I believe that the greatest honor we, especially her young descendants, can pay to her legacy is by acquiring a passionate desire to to emulate her fine example and to live lives worthy of honor, praise, and admiration. As her earthly pilgrimage comes to an end, we firmly and confidently believe that her soul will rest in eternal peace. And let the church say, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Hymn number 223, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, church. I'm Sharon Gibson, first grandchild of my late grandmother, Edith Butcher. I'll be reading in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 8. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what which we planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away, a time to rend, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace. This is the word of the Lord. I miss you, Gran-Gran.
Psalm 23, the Cremon Virgin. The congregation may remain sitting where the choir leads us in the psalm.
Thank you. The second Bible reading, Sister Jenny Mason.
Good afternoon. The Bible lesson reading is taken from Revelation chapter 21, from verses 2 to 7. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow or crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water and life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Here ends the reading.
Hymn number 387, To God Be the Glory.
First of all, let me speak to Brother Butcher. Brother Butcher, you come from over and away, and our liability insurance, we do not want to use it. So be very careful with your psychomotor skills. Rest eternal, God, unto her, O Lord. May her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed through the tender mercy of God rest in peace. Kindly be seated. To use a polite expression, I'm vertically challenged. And when I come to these lecterns, sometimes I have to remove or step on one of them. When I was a young priest in the Cathedral Church of St. George and Andrew in Kingston, St. Vincent, Archbishop Woodruff sometimes, when I preached before him in the Cathedral Church, he was a bit upset because I had to put a little step thing for me to get up, and then he would forget to move, and he was tall and strapping, and he wasn't as pleased that he had to get it removed. Whenever death does occur, so many things go through our thoughts. Imagine me much younger. I'm 78, now the first time July this year. Imagine me much younger. Reeds Bay, Lower Weston, St. James, near John Moore Shop. Rain, rain, go away. Death, death, go away. The bunny said, come back and get out of there though. Death is never welcome. The Bible says the last enemy is death. The best panegyrics, the greatest eulogies, the best floral arrangements, death is still an enemy. How do you look at it? You know and I know, as the Bayesian expression is, you get a grief lump, nothing going up and nothing coming down. You don't know your head and you don't know your foot. You're like a dog chasing around, you're like a tail to catch it up. Yes. She suddenly appears. It is there, and he surprises all of us. The last enemy, death. So the two things certain in life I would want to believe. One, you have to pay taxes, or sorry, you should pay taxes. And secondly, death. And death, when lingering, piece of you seems to die every single moment with the loved one. Suddenly, you leave home, you don't come back, you go sleep, and you wake up dead just like that there, so to speak. So death is really as an enemy. But the part I just quoted from Sacred Writ, thanks be to God who gives the victory in Jesus Christ our Lord. That's a great thing for us as the Christian believers. It is not the end, it's almost at the beginning, so to speak. Yes, almost like a leveler. It is said that Alexander the Great, when he died, he made some requests. One, he asked that physicians, medical practitioners, carry his body to show that they did not have the last say. And secondly, he asked that his money be scattered in front of him because we was going to their gods, as I would say then. If he did take it, it would be of no use. You and I then realize the shortness and uncertainty of human life. People used to die in the 90s and 80s. And since I've been here pro tempore for the time being for the substantive priest, the incumbent, the Reverend Mrs. Rosalind Harper Johnson, I've had to perform the service of Christian burial for people 20-something and 40-something. I've used an illustration before, the floral tribute over there. If you look carefully, some are in full bloom, 98 and 188, and some are tender, 27 and 41. Almost as though God seems to be taking his flowers, you, taking, and as if to make a bouquet. It seems that way. Some of us believe we can do what we like, when we like, how we like, but never as long as we like. Let me use an agricultural illustration. I have two from where I am already. So in Lower Carlton, St. James, and other agricultural areas, we have something called a hedgerow. I don't know about this community, so I'm not trying to belittle you. I don't know how agricultural or seafaring we are here. And the hedgerows are planted to keep in the earth. But the basic expression, the one I know when I grew up, every piece of ground got a hedgerow. They can walk from one side, and sooner or later, they got to reach the other hedgerow. And life is like that. Sooner or later, there comes an end, because it was a beginning. So, it does not really matter. Handy guy, 5th July 1945. And how long down there? You see, it's not really the length of a person's life. It's the quality and how long I live. But what did I do when I was alive? I've used this illustration before. We Christian believers, I do nobody no bad. But is anybody any good? This is a different thing, indeed. So since we know the taxes we must and should pay, and since we know death will come sooner or later, death go away, don't come, how are we preparing? So often as Christian believers, it's a matter, I am bound for the promised land, this world is not my own, I'm passing through. And the Lord said, I want you in the promised land. And I said, Oh Lord, hold on. I am just passing through. And the Lord said, you've passed through. Lord, let me pass through some more. In spite of the challenges of our life. And so there's some qualities we want to think about, to emulate. We don't want time to get rid of them, nor eternity ever to remove or forget them. Our sister from her son, the eulogist, was said to be a woman of peace. You see, peace, the shalom in the Hebrew, the salam in the Arabic, is not merely an absence of war. It's a totality of being. Shalom, Shabbat, as the Jewish people will say, peace. Not only you get the peace from God, and may have the peace of God in your life, then you're able to share. If you don't have the peace of God, then you know from where I'm going. The Bayesian expression, it ain't me, it is you, you're confused. I wake up this morning, I say my prayers, it ain't me, it is you, you're confused. For some of us as human beings, whatever good we do, it is never enough. To use the expression, if we do, we're damned. For some people, if we do not do, we're just as damned. So you and I need to spend time in reflection to cultivate in peace. Not merely that young girl next door neighbor who will wake up on Sunday morning and light fire and your Sunday white clothes get smoke upon them. I don't mean that type of thing, so. I mean in a well-being. And to reach that, it means spending time with God. I often smile to myself. We Christian believers, now we worship the Prince of Peace, you know. We're supposed to be peacemakers, not peace wanters. And I always smile with us in all these denominations, you know. This body, so the Roman Catholics going straight that place. The Anglicans go there, and we're the only ones going this place. Lord, have us mercy. If down here, as peacemakers, we can get on, but the Lord may wake a whole bunch of you when we try to get up there. If you see what I mean. I'm talking about the peace we ought to have. If you see what I mean. Steady working at it. Blessed are peace likers? No. Blessed are the peace wanters? No. The peace makers. And so often in life, I really get an old using these Bayesian expressions, you know, you had to cut your nose and spoil your features. I don't see many too many younger ones. I can explain. I think Brother Butcher, he's about 20 years younger, so he may be able to explain some of these expressions. Peace in our lives. Tranquility. We all need that. All around. Everything can be gone upside down. But that calmness that stillness. You remember when everything went upside down and God was heard in the still, small voice. So often we have to sit down, and so often in life, everything else crowds out the voice of God. And so often it may well be no longer what the Bible says, speak, Lord, your servant listen, but Lord, I speak into you, I want this, and I want that, as though God is a Santa Claus, just like that. It's not really so. So we have that peace. So one thing we can learn from her life as an example to look at our own and the areas of war, how we struggle against ourselves and saints of God, remember, our past never defines us. God does not create junk. So the past can't define us. We all make mistakes, but we're not limited by our past. You see, the challenge is when you fall down, that's human. You look around, see if anybody see you, and you get up and go on. The thing is, when you fall down, you don't stop them. The trouble is falling down and not making the effort to get up. The Bible says we press on toward the high mark of our calling in Jesus Christ. That's what we're talking about. We're moving on then, so to speak. That brings peace. Forget the past. You cannot come to kneel the altar rail or commute, whatever, in any denomination, your whole burden down. It's as though when I taught at the law school, in giving some children something, somebody could take out the book bag, you know, you bought the car and carry that way. Some of us as Christians, we need that inner healing, You know when your sister told a light point, you still got it in your mind all right now? And when the teacher beat you wrongfully or rightfully, you still got it all right? If I had a big rock, I would what? Anyhow. And so you carry all that pain with you. And I said, we Christians so often go to the foot of the cross with the pain and the burden, and we get back up the same way. I'm not being unkind, but even Christian believers, they don't have, what you call, a chip on the shoulder. Some of us as Christians, we have a whole lumber yard, not even a chip on our shoulders, so to speak. So we here today to think of peace. Peace, you and I are well aware, some of the events that happen, they surprise us, they astonish us, and we don't know what is happening. Peace. Secondly, she was a motivator. She was a mentor, a nourisher, a nurturer as well. Men are said to provide and protect, and women nourish and nurture. Mentorship. The days could be that two parents were not on speaking terms, but that and the guy would pass and look up some adult in her face. But by the time I got home, although my mother may, I'm not saying this to my mother, I'm not be speaking to that woman's mother, you know, I'd be quite warm when it came to sitting down. I couldn't exactly sit down because of the warmth I would have got. So we're talking of mentorship. There used to be a mentorship program. My deceased uncle was a plumber, Emerson, and he mentored some people. You didn't get much money, but learn the trade. You and I, as adults, so often we are not able or do not set the proper example. We don't mentor them. We're always possibly thinking the worst of them. In so doing, sometimes we forget our past. It might not have been as blameless as we would want to use it with our rose-colored glasses now. So example matters. Our children are so often taught by what they see and not what we tell them. It is a lunch time, a luncheon. The guests have been invited. At that household, prayers were not said neither before or after meals. And the mother, for some reason, asked the child to pray. The child told the mother she did not know what to say. The mother said, "Well, you say what you always hear me telling God when we have guests." Eyes were closed, hands were put together. Remember, children, see. And then the child said, "Lord, why did I invite so many people here? Thank you very much. Why did I invite so many people here for lunch today?" Because the child had seen what was happening. We as senior citizens, they call us now, so often we need to pay a check on ourselves. So often we may be at fault. That they have, please, that comes from the life of our sister. I am going where I should have started. I've kept the best for the last. Our sister was a devoted Christian. Saints, note very carefully, churchianity is not Christianity. I offer to you that the two very different things. And again, I've used this illustration, and I'm proud to use it again and again today. In my garage at home, I put my motor car. When I take any dog or cat and put it in the garage, it's a cat or a dog, it is not a motor car. So when I go to church on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, that does not necessarily mean that I'm really what I ought to be, that my morning word and my evening word are agreeing. It does not necessarily mean that at all. You and I are the household of faith. We need to look at ourselves carefully. Today, we may cry, we may lament. Jesus had a friend, Lazarus. He cried. The reason, like, it was deep in his spirit. And if he, the perfect human, could do that, we could do it. But the Bible says, we do not sorrow as those who have no hope. So we will cry, lament, but we still have hope. So since we know the certainty of death, I want to invite you to the man. I have a man in my life. I recommend this man to anybody at all. Jesus the Christ. He loved me so much. He died for me. And by the way, He has died for you as well. He shed his precious blood on Calvary's cross. So I want that relationship with him. I will repeat, I ain't saying a thing about going to church. We as Anglican Christians, for by grace are you saved, not of works, lest anybody should boast. Getting baptized as infant and adult, having incense and speaking in tongues, they are good and fine. Wonderful, wonderful. A personal relationship. I know. A testament. Not my grandmother told my grandfather, my grandmother was a sexton, and my aunt was saying in the choir that
personal relationship, whether altar call day or in our Anglican Church's confirmation, we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, Acts 8, 14 to 17, and 19, 1 to 6, and the sevenfold gifts given in the prophecy of Isaiah. Each denomination will have its own as a response. In our case, it is through confirmation. We publicly declare Jesus is our personal Savior. So please consider that. Well, I know some obstacles. The pastor bad and the priest bad. So, I never say they are or they are not. I don't want the judge to sit on the bench for me, so I don't say that at all. But, Ezekiel, no longer shall it be said, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. No, the soul that sinneth it shall die. Personal responsibility. Let God deal with bad pastors and the bad priests, and he will deal with you personally. So please forget those are leaders, how we fall down. We may have shoulders of iron, but trust me, as human beings, we have feet of clay. Continue to pray for every last one of us, regardless of any denominational ties. So I invite you to this man, a loving Savior. Please consider it. And we who are left behind, judgment begins God's house, God's. Lord, did I not prophesy? I don't even know you. When I was hungry, you ain't given nothing to eat. And when I was 30, not even a drop of water to wet my white lips. So we then try to make the calling and the election sure. You and I are saints. We've come too far, too long to turn back now. So then, today, we have mixed emotions. So sad that some a child of God, he has taken to himself. So happy that for which she longed and hoped, she'll finally achieve. To those who are bereaved at this time, the substantive incumbent, the Reverend Mrs. Rosin Harper Johnson, the parochial church councils, as well as our church bodies, church organizations, or lay ministers of the Eucharist, or organists, or sexton, as well as our ITC ministry, and it's not sterilizers there, sanitizers. Yes, the sanitizers. And everyone else form part of our parish family, our churches dedicated to God's glory and honor, and in memory of Mark, evangelist and martyr, Catherine of Alexandria, Virgin and Martyr, not to be confused with Catherine of Siena. We, along with the Reverend Miss Stephanie Ann Wedderburn, we offer our condolences and our prayers. As far as humanly possible to share with you, we give you empathy, not merely sorry, giving you sympathy. The God of all hope and consolation will uphold you and surround you at this time. And so then, Michael the Archangel, meaning who's like God, Raphael, God's healer, Gabriel, God's hero, the one of God's healing power, and the ninefold order of angels, angels, archangels, cherubim, seraphim, thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, and virtues. Before the most blessed, glorious, and undivided Trinity, when the trumpet shall sound, and then that blessed Trinity will say, welcome home, my child, welcome home. I did not check the protocol before, and if I have broken the protocol, either the ADC or Her Excellency will correct me. I can't welcome her because this is her church, her mother church. She can't welcome somebody to their own house. But we acknowledge her presence, and I don't want to be presumptuous. So if I break any protocol, I suspect I'll be sternly admonished afterwards. I suspect, almost of a firm belief, that the condolences we just offered, she would want to join with them. If I believe I know her to be a very gracious and a God-fearing, practicing Christian believer, I suspect in my own mind she would want to join with me in offering the condolences and prayers to you as well. I've got a nod from her. I think I'm safe ground now. The heart gone on from not beating so fast. Right. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. May her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed through the tender mercy of God rest in peace. Amen.
Please stand and we will say the Apostles' Creed on page 5. The hymn for the offering, number 246, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
You're kindly asked to note that the priest in charge has given permission for this particular offering collection to go toward the ITC ministry or laptop broke down. So she's given permission, it's quite all right. And we thank you very much. And we continue to ask God's blessing on your house and household, whether you're able to give or you feel you could not give at this particular time, it doesn't matter to us. The idea for us as Anglicans is not collecting money, even for the ongoing work of the church. If you're able to give, give generously, and if it's a thing that does not keep much noise, even the better for you. But of course, if you find it at this moment you can't do it, God bless you and your household as well. And we thank you very, very much indeed.
My watch reminded me to take some water. It's very hot these days. If perchance you don't have a watch, say something like that. As I reminded you before we started the service, do please, Nepal, get some water. Do not become dehydrated. And I'll also remind you can catch your important call on your mobile phone outside. So please, please, do not become dehydrated. Step out, get your water, and come back in. We thank you.
Good afternoon, Church. Madam President, nice to see you. Before I begin this prayers, I would like to thank Canon Guy for allowing me the opportunity to say these prayers. And I feel it would be remiss of me if I didn't say a few words on behalf of Sister Butcher, because I couldn't live with myself. So I crave your indulgence just for a few minutes to say three things about this wonderful lady and this faithful servant of God and the impact that she has had on my life from birth until now. First, apart from God, she's one of the three persons responsible for my entry into this world. My mother, her mother, who was the midwife at the time, and Sister Butcher herself. The story goes, I grew up hearing it. My mother and Sister Butcher were best friends. I'm told I was due on the Thursday, the 16th of July, 1953, but I didn't come until the 17th of July, the next day. So y'all would imagine the labor pains that my poor mother would have gone through. The whole day, the night, and then part of the next day. And eventually, when I came, I refused to cry, which is very important as far as I understand. There are many challenges for people who, children who refuse to cry. So I'm told that some blows were administered, necessary slappings and burns on the little unsuspecting buttocks at the time. I understand she had to work very hard and didn't stop until I cried. I always remember my sister telling me, Gail, Sister Butcher had to work really hard on you. So because of her, I'm here now 70 years this year. And for that, I thank her. I'm truly grateful. Next thing I'm going to tell you, she always called me by my baptismal names, and this more does that to every time she sees me, Gailinel, Gailinel. Secondly, we didn't only have that special bond, we shared a passion and a love for singing. And y'all know Lady Blue Shoe loves to sing. On evenings when she was much stronger and used to sit by the door, I would go and we would all sing. She taught me many songs, songs I've never heard before, and I'm sure many of you never heard. I'm sure Canon Guy never heard about these songs either, too. I have pleasant memories of these songs, but she would always do that. You know what that meant? Wrong tune. And I had to start all over again. One evening, I decided to get smart. So I went home, and I got my typewriter, and I typed it. I have it right here. The 12th of January, 2018, hilarious and enjoyable songs, amazingly sung by my cousin, Mrs. Edith Butcher, at 93 years old. And that was her birthday. That was being specific. The songs were like, Poor Old Kitty, Granny Old Armchair, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, A German Musician, The Chicken Song, and Miss Jessie's Daughter. After practicing and practicing, and I'd gone back the next day, you know what happened? Wrong tune again. I had to start all over again. Could never get it right with Sister Butcher. You must have the right tune, the rhythm, the melody, everything. Third, in closing, it was ironic that just as she spent some time with me on the day that I came into the world, I was able to spend some time with her the day that she passed. I was happy to be there the morning. I prayed with her. Bernadette and Del were also there. I prayed and they do the singing. Oh dear, have mercy. So as I say this now, I pass my sincere condolences to the family, and I thank you for allowing me to share in her many birthday celebrations. I really appreciated that. And I strongly believe that Sister Butcher is already in the arms of Jesus, and she's singing in the heavenly choir. Can I have an amen for that, please? Thank you. May she rest in peace, a wonderful woman, one of a kind. Rest in peace and rise in glory. We'll now go on to... We'll now go on to the prayers. And we pray for those who mourn. we commemorate the departed Edith Adele Butcher. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy. May we be strengthened in our faith, live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy. Show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister, Edith Adele, who was reborn by water and the Spirit and holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. And thank you.
This part of the service may be strange to some of you. You said you've been hearing about Russia and Ukraine. This part of the service comes from there. The Orthodox Rite Church.
We as Christian believers, we are Catholic, a word meaning universal, a word where we have branches all over the place. I didn't say a Roman Catholic. Over that side of the world, it's called the Kontakion of the Departed, the Commendation. Ordinarily, we use incense, one of the gifts the wise men or the Magi offer to the infant Jesus. Revelation says you're going to have incense in heaven in worship. And also, holy water, a sign, a symbol, a sacramental, remind us of our baptism into Jesus the Christ. Kindly stand for the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. You honor immortal, the creator, the maker of humankind, and we are mortal from the earth, and the earth shall return. For so you did it when you ordained, when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust we shall return. All of us go down to the grave, to the dust, sorry, yet even at the grave we make our song, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And Redeemer, deliver your servant Edith Adele, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in eternal habitation, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Edith Adele. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a son of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of the blessed rest of the everlasting peace and in the glorious company of the saints in light through the same Jesus Christ, O Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord.
Amen.
Kindly be seated.
The
the family members of the deceased, particularly the chief mourners, they thank you very much for your presence at the service of Christian Bell. Just kindly be reminded, the family does appreciate any condolences in person that you may want to offer them, but they offer a suggestion. Today may not be the most appropriate time for them in their grief. So your condolences and your prayers, they're willing to accept on another occasion. If I seem a bit befuddled, as you might well be, I'm trying to explain as politely as I possibly can. We're not going to have any repast after the service. So we thank you. We here, St. Catherine of St. Mark, St. Mark with Catherine, we want to wish you as Christian believers that you have a closer walk with God. And please consider that relationship with him. Secondly, we want you to have emotional peace. All the toxicity and negativity that is wrong, try to avoid it for your system at least. Get a good emotional peace. Thirdly, we want to have good physical health. And for some people, we want to have financial stability and security. I exclude Dr. Winsmore Butcher for that one. He may not need any financial security and stability. He has a very good pension, I was want to suspect, but never mind. And do get home safely, very, very safely. And we thank you very much. I suspect, I'm awaiting word, I may have to do the committal here in the church building, or rules allow for that. I've been told previously that the weather's a bit inclement where we're going to Memorial Garden. So we'll do the committal here, and we're bounden, I have to by law, but when I work overseas anyhow, to make sure that the body's properly covered, and we'll have the gravesite hymns at the gravesite. So you'll still get the service. Only one part in here. We don't want people scampering all over the place like that there, anyhow. So, and when we reach there, the burial site, you're kindly reminded, please get help from the funeral home. Once again, we in Barbados, like a lot of law and everything, the churches of St. Catherine and St. Mark, along with the funeral home, as well as the Coleridge Memorial Gardens, if you refuse any help, and God forbid anything happens to you, we are liable under no condition, no condition. So please accept the help offer. We don't want anybody slipping or falling like that. So the service will continue as that hymn is announced, and then afterward, we'll do what we have to do. Kindly stand.
The recessional hymn number 515, Come We That Love the Lord, followed by the Nonconformists.
Thank you.
Lay ministers, please. 373, I think, according to your prisoner. Not that one, please. It's 373. Let me make sure I have it. I think you are correct, but just let me double check, sir. Thank you very much. I am incorrect. Thank you. Ensure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Edith Adele, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and we beseech you in infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our sister Edith Adele and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant it for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious to her. The Lord lift up his countenance upon her and give her peace. Unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Remember, O Lord, this your servant, Edith Adele, who has gone before us with a sign of faith, and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to her and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. We have the guests in the traditional manner, and please note when we reach the burial site, we only have the hymns to be sung now. As I told you before, to avoid any stampede or anybody getting wet and getting a cold or anything like that, so that's why we've done it here in the church building. Christ is risen from the dead. Trampling down death by death. And giving life to those in the tomb.
the Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen. Giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. Sir, just step aside that the others can pass. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace. Step aside, please. Thank you. Having taken away the sin of the world, Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father." Inherit the kingdom prepared for you. Into paradise, may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the holy martyrs receive you. With Lazarus once poor, may you have eternal rest. Yes, I have no choice. Thank you very much, right there. Thanks again. Not this time.
hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. It's shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. And I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Yeah, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a
yeah. please, on the count of three, raise it. I have a challenge. I hear the music, but you get it. Could you let me finish off, sir? I raise it. Just let me finish off, sir. Right. I have a challenge. I hear it well, but to get the talk of my mouth correctly when it comes to the music, it doesn't work out. So I'll count to three, and somebody can raise it. I mean, thank you very much. The number 13, 1, 3, through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy. May you his servant, you his service, your delight, your want shall be his care. 1, 2, 3. Is fairly saturated, a bit wet, and so it's going to take the soil technicians some time to cover the body. So we may have to sing over some of the hymns, but be quite patient with us. We really appreciate it indeed. Our music, as in this modern day and age, with this modern technology, is all pre-recorded for us. You don't have to bother about my voice or your voice anymore, except to sing, and I suspect they usually have these wonderful choirs from Azerbaijan, say, over and away. So when the hymn is announced, Sister Sonia will be able to, or who else in charge, will be able to do everything for you. Let me announce the hymn. Hold on.
Next hymn is page 14, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Of him in glory, will the toil of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Stop it all. Emma, you ready?
All right.
Let us raise our voices now and sing. One family, one love. Praising God for everything. One family, one love. Hold on together. Missions forever. Looking with hope to the God above. One family, one love. Through the years we struggle and we fight. One family, one love. Pressing on with power and might. One family, one love. Hold on together. Masons forever. Looking with hope to the God. Celebrate, my people, celebrate. One family, one love. Banners raised, don't hesitate. One family, one love. Hold on together. Missions forever. With hope to the God above, one family, one love. Hold on together, missions forever. Looking with hope to the God above, one family, one. One day a mother came to a prison to see an errant but precious son. She told the warden how much she loved him. It did not matter what he had done. She did not bring to him
parola,
pardon free.
She brought no silver,
no gold,
none to see.
It was a hollow bright,
sent down from heavens
like the sweetest gift, a mother's smile. Her boy had drifted far from the fireside, though she had pleaded with him each night. Yet not a word did she ever utter that told her heartaches. Her smile was bright.
She did not
bring to him
parole or
pardon free.
She brought no silver,
no gold,
no gold,
none to see.
It was a hollow bright,
sent down from heavens like the sweetest gift, a mother's smile. She left her smile, son, you can remember. She's gone to heaven from heartaches free. The bars around you could never change her. You were her baby, and ever be. She did not bring to him.
Are you one of those?
Brought no gold, none to see. Hollow bright, heaven's light, the sweetest gift, a mother's smile. Bring to him
parole of
pardon free.
Brought
no gold, none to see.
Last one, our loved ones.
Our loved ones have gone from this region of woe, no more on this earth to roam. Her voice is now ringing up yonder, I know she's moved to a better home. She's singing up there,
she is
singing up yonder in those bright mansions of rest. There she is true, true with all sorrow ever, her soul shall be blessed. Yes, we shall meet her tomorrow with the redeemed gone before, united for yonder forever, where sorrow shall come nevermore. The one whom we love has gone yonder to stay, alone we must journey through. Our heavenly Father has called her away to mansions beyond the blue. She's singing up there, singing up yonder, in those bright mansions of rest. There she is true, true with all sorrow ever, her soul shall be blessed. Yes, we shall meet her tomorrow with the redeemed gone before, united forever, where sorrow shall come evermore. Tomorrow we'll meet on that faraway shore and join in the singing grand. Sad partings and heartaches will come nevermore up yonder in Beulah Land. She's singing up there, singing up yonder, in those bright mansions of rest. There she is true, true with all sorrow ever, her soul shall be blessed. Yes, we shall meet her tomorrow with the redeemed gone before, united forever, where sorrow shall come never.